put the who's it on the what's it. Attach the what's it to the who's it. Connect the thingamajig to the thingamabob, and that'll make the whatchamacallit go. You hook the gidget to the gadget.
Well, hello there. Welcome to Making Records. I'm here in Studio Topanga Dice. You may be wondering, what is Making Records? Well, I've done a fair amount of sharing information about the recordings that I've done over the years. I've done it through forums. I've done it through other folks, you know, video outlets. And I've always really enjoyed it. And I've only done it when sort of opportunities presented themselves and people came to me and asked me to participate and stuff. And I did it. And I thought, at this point, I think I'd rather just have a direct outlet so I can just do it whenever, you know, something comes up that I think would be really interesting to share. And so it's a little more real time. So as I'm working on things, I can share stuff and I can just have a more consistent flow. And I'm going to try and do something every week. I don't know if I'm actually going to pull that off, but we'll see. Hopefully I can, you know, keep up a fairly steady flow of interesting things to check out. It's going to be a combination of a few different things. I'll do some stuff that's more technical, that's really specifically about a specific recording technique. I'm going to do some episodes that are deep dive deconstructions into specific songs that might be familiar to people. So we'll pull up the multi-track master of a song and just pick through every single track, and I'll talk about, you know, how it was recorded and whatever recollections I have about the experience of creating the song, you know, or at least being a part of that process. And so so that's the idea. And, you know, hopefully it'll be interesting, you know, or maybe possibly even helpful for some folks out there. So this very first episode, the timing seemed appropriate to do a deep dive deconstruction. And it's, people may already be aware of this, but it is the 20th anniversary of the release of the song All Star. It came out, it was released to the public on May 4th in 1999. So we're just a few days past, the initial release of the song. And so in those 20 years, that song has kind of gotten everywhere. It was kind of unbelievable what happened with it. We certainly, you know, didn't expect anything other than hopefully people would like a song that we were trying to make as cool as possible at the time. And you know, it just kind of got around everywhere. So it's been pretty unbelievable what happened with it. It's a lot.
Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed. And she was looking kind of dumb with a finger and a thumb in the shape of an L on her forehead. The years start coming and they don't stop coming.
Fed up to the rules, so I hit the ground running.
Didn't it make sense not to live for fun? It's a little bit of a paradox, but what we found was, as your brain gets smart, your head gets
dumb. So much to do. So much to see.
So much wrong with taking the back streets.
You'll never know if you don't go.
You'll never shine
if you don't go.
Hey now, you're a rock star. Get the show on. Get it paid.
All that glitters is gold.
Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me. I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed.
Mom! Smash Mouth! Smash Mouth!
Somebody once told me the world. Somebody once told me. Somebody once. Somebody once. Somebody wants, 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 somebody wants
So, yeah, that's kind of crazy. I mean, it was in multiple movies. They played at sports events. Generations, you know, of all ages seemed to really love and react to the song. It fit into all kinds of different demographics. I know for some people it was like a guilty pleasure song. But, you know, there was a lot of people, young, old, little, very young kids, you know, everything in between, people would find something that they really enjoyed about the song. It's just kind of irresistible. It's just a fun, inspiring song. So I thought this would be a good first start. And for this, I'm very, very fortunate so that I'm going to have somebody join me for it. It is the actual songwriter of this song, and he and I worked together to put all the finishing touches on the song after the basics were recorded with the band, and everybody had done their specific overdubs. All the little details we did together. So let me bring him in now. Hi, so here he is, Greg Camp.
I'm Greg Camp. This is
Eric Valentine. Like I said earlier, I'm still that guy. So we're just going to start picking through this session. Greg was kind enough to dig up his original demo of the song, which was really, really cool to hear. This one is just instrumental. There was one with vocals as well.
But couldn't find it.
Yeah, couldn't
find it. And back then, I think we mixed everything to cassette. And so it's very possible that cassette is stuck like in a car at the bottom of a ravine somewhere.
You know? Right. But we do have the original demo. So I think it might be cool to just start there. And the thing that's really incredible about this, and I've talked about this before in interviews and stuff, what's amazing about Greg's demos and what you'll recognize immediately is that it's pretty much exactly the same thing as the final song, because, you know, I'm going to tell everybody how amazing you are now. His demos are incredibly well-realized versions of the songs. They're really very, very much complete, and my job was basically to not fuck that up as much as possible, because there's always a really cool vibe and feel in the demos, and we wanted to sort of expand the sonics of it. And without losing the cool vibe. So check this out. This is really, really cool. So obviously, it's all there. The bass line and the little skank guitars. So that's the same drum loop that's used on the final album version. We had Michael Urbano play live drums on top of this as well, just to add a little more, fidelity to the whole thing.
What happened to the metal? We lost the metal.
That's right.
Overprocessed, you know. Guitar.
You forgot to bring that pedal. The metal pedal.
Yeah,
but it's all there. All the way down to the cool transitions, the bow, you know, going into the chorus. And then later, like, okay, so here's the bridge. The cool filtered drum loops and stuff. And we may have used your original version. No, I think we did redo those.
Yeah, I mean, they're cut. They're either chopped a little differently or whatever. But what was that little box that we both had?
Dr. Beat.
Dr. Beat. Yeah. That's where all those filter sweeps came from.
Yeah. Okay. And then I want to play the third verse as well. Because... So, just like the final version, goes to this cool acoustic guitar version of the verse. And then the same transition. All of a sudden, there's these cool clean guitars playing the arpeggio. So, you know, the song was already really, you know, laid out, and it really was just a matter of trying to like expand the sound of it, the sonics of it. We added a couple little things. There's like a couple little keyboard trills and stuff. Yeah, so this doesn't have any of the organ stuff that we added.
No.
You know, pretty much everything else was the same. We re-recorded all the guitars and all that stuff. But the ideas are the same. The demo was right, and there was no reason to try and reinvent it. You know, it's something that can be hard to do because you know everybody wants to sort of make their mark on things and feel like they're making an important contribution. But you know, if something's really right, then you just leave it alone. So there was no reason to reinvent this song from the demo. So we'll start picking through the actual album version. I have it pulled up here. Multi-track session. I'm just going to hit play. This is everything playing. I did a very quick balancing of this thing, and I was just pleased to see how easy it is to just put this thing together and have it really sound like something. You know, I think I actually probably worked a little too hard on the original mix because... this was easy and it sounds great.
Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me.
Yeah.
I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed. She was looking kind of dumb with her finger and her thumb in the shape of an L on her forehead.
I saw it coming
and they don't stop coming.
Okay, yeah, I was in the middle of doing some fancy busing stuff. Okay, here we go.
Sharpest tool in the shed.
There it is.
She was looking kind of dumb with her finger and her thumb.
The organ trill, that was my Hammond M2 organ. And it's funny, you can hear there's a bunch of stuff. I've got like a track of outtakes from that was left on one of the multi-track masters. So here's the performed part. Blit it.
Not very exciting yet. Huh?
No. So enter the Roland Chorus Echo, SRE 555. And so the tape delay is panned opposite of the little organ trill that was played, and then you get that.
Yeah. I do remember a few things about maybe not particularly this song, but you would always say, "All right, Mr. Camp, man your station," and I would have to go back to the Roland Space Echo or Chorus Echo and sit back there, and we would do all this stuff on the fly.
You know,
like, okay, it's time to, you know, turn the feedback up and do something crazy. You're like, okay.
Yep.
That was my position.
Tape delays are an instrument. You can play those like an instrument. You can actually, once it starts echoing, you can adjust the pitch, you know, affects the time and the pitch together, but we would bend things, you know, to follow chord changes and stuff. It was actually on the third record where we did a bunch of that.
Mm-hmm.
What was the song? I can't remember now.
Next episode.
Yeah. All right. But just sort of an overview of how this was recorded. Right now, everything's been transferred into a Pro Tools session, so we have all of the tracks available in one place. But originally, this stuff was recorded on analog tapes. And so there was a few things in the computer. There was the drum loops and a click track for everybody to play to, but the drums were played live directly onto analog masters, bass, guitar, vocals, all that stuff was done directly onto analog tape. I think in the case of the lead vocals, it would get transferred into the computer, or I even maybe tracked it in the computer so I could get a comp, but ultimately everything ends up on the analog masters.
Right.
And so this is a transfer of those analog masters. I've always used a combination of two tape machines, a Studer 824 track, and I believe for these sessions, the Ampex MM1200 was set up as a 24 track as well, so we would have as many tracks as possible. Yeah, there's no way all of this would have fit on only 38 tracks. Because you have to give up a track on each machine for time code. And so this looks more like 46 tracks worth of stuff. Mm-hmm. And so that's how it was done. This drum track, we'll start isolating some stuff on this, was recorded live onto an analog master. No editing, no comping, no nothing. Hmm. That's
Mr. Urbano.
Yep, Michael Urbano for you. He's done that for me quite a few times. And he played on these couple of songs, this one and then The Morning Comes, because we were extremely short on time.
Right. These were the two last songs added
to the record. After we had turned in the record, and the record company said, nope, you need more songs. That part of the story has been out there for a little while, so I don't know if it's necessary to repeat it, but, you know, basically they said, we're not sure we have a first single, go and do some more songs. Greg sequestered himself away to do that and showed up with All Star, a very complete sounding version of All Star, and then The Morning Comes, the first two singles off the record. Mm-hmm. So, well done.
Thank you.
It doesn't always go that way.
No, that's a pressure too, because you got the rest of the band. Like, I mean, we all loved the record as it was.
Yes. You know? Yeah. We thought we had delivered them a finished masterpiece. But. Yeah. And to their credit, man, potentially this song would not have come out if they had said,
true.
Yeah, cool.
True. Oh yeah.
This is great. All right. So, Mr. Urbano. So here's the drums. Yeah, so that's all just the live drum track. And this was my usual recording setup in this era. So I'm a very kick-centric drum recorder. And so there's an inside kick mic, two outside kick mics, and then there are some room mics that were there to sort of enhance the kick drum sound. And so here is the inside kick mic, which is kind of what you'd expect. It's that really claustrophobic, tiny little sort of, you know, clicky sounding thing with a low end attached to it. Yeah, so this is a mic that's out in front of the kick drum. And this one's obviously gated. And this was probably closer to the floor. I'd try and get one sort of up higher and one down lower. One's more subby.
Do you remember which mics those were?
Boy. At the time, it was probably an ATM-25, an Audio-Technica mic on the inside. Mm-hmm. Probably a 47 FET on the outside. And then I also...
That one sounds great.
Yeah, I like this one. This was probably my 47 tube mic. That was the one that I put, you know, like 6 feet away.
Yeah.
To just get the whole sound of the drum. I've never been a huge fan of only close miking drums. It just... Nobody listens to a drum with their ear 2 inches away from it. So it's never really sounded like drums to me. Mm-hmm. So, that's what really makes it sound like a kick drum. And the other stuff just sort of enhances that. So then, snare drum. Let's see, this is gated as what this mic would have been. I think that's probably just a 57. That's what it sounds like to me. And then, so this is what I call the K/S mic, kick/snare mic. And so it's a mic that's on the batter side of the kick drum, directly below the snare drum, facing the kick drum head. And it was typically a U87. Boom, right there, mm-hmm. looking that way. And it would get like an equal helping of the bottom of the snare drum and that sort of knocky attack on the kick drum. So that's yet another kick drum source. And so all those things together sort of help, you know, shape the kick drum sound. And here's a hi-hat mic. I don't remember what that was in back then. I think it was like an AKG 451. Small diaphragm condenser mic. The overheads, yeah, those are definitely my C12As. Mm-hmm. I think for the rest of the record, I was renting a pair of actual C12s. I was doing that a lot in the 90s from Stephen Jarvis. Mm-hmm. This session came up so short, such short notice that I just used my C12As. And there's no tom mics, because normally I would use the C12As as tom mics, but I ended up not doing that. And I think we may have just not even had any toms set up.
I don't hear any toms in this song at all.
There are toms in this song, but it's a sample.
Yeah. Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
And so then this is the mono kit mic. So this was, at that time, it was always a Coles 4038 ribbon mic, just like, you know, 4 feet in front of the drum kit, looking in, you know, like in at the snare drum, right, mm-hmm. right across the rack tom. Yeah, and so I put a little bit of a high pass filter on there and stuff for this little reference mix.
I hear ambience too somehow.
Yeah, there's a little bit of reverb on there too.
Oh, I see.
Just to kind of match the original mix.
Right.
And then there's stereo room mics that get added in the choruses. In the final mix, you can really hear those. They just add all this thickness and energy and density to the choruses. So in here, I put a little bit of compression on them. This thing is on there, and no EQ, just kind of a big boomy room sound. And so then, the interesting thing, I found a bunch of these duplications of the kick and snare mics, and what they are was me creating look ahead triggers for the gates for the drums. So when I used to record drums on analog tape, you don't have the luxury of having a plugin that has built-in look ahead for the gate. And so what I would do is I would go to the end of the song, flip the tape over, and bounce the track from one track to another with a little bit of delay on there. So then when it records backwards from the end of the song to the beginning of the song, you flip the tape back over and you have a duplicate of the snare drum except moved forward a little bit. And so I could use that. I would do it maybe like 10 to 15 milliseconds. And so I'd send that to the key input of the gate that's on the snare drum, so the snare drum gate would open just before the snare drum hits each time.
Interesting.
It was really the only way to do it, you know, before I discovered the Fab Filter gate plugin, which is
right.
The best thing in the universe. And so so these, you can hear, I had one that I used for the room mics. The room mics are already delayed, you know, that amount of milliseconds. If they're 15 feet away, they'll be mm-hmm. delayed 15 milliseconds. And so you can hear them flaming against each other. So mm-hmm. this is the snare mic. This is the one that's advanced by a little bit. And that's the one that I use to trigger the gates for the room mics.
Back streets, you'll never know if you don't go. You'll never
so here's the loops. And the you know, pretty much the same loops. We added, I don't, was this in the original?
No, this is yours.
Yeah. Yeah, so this we added. And then there's this guy. That was in the original demo. And then there was an experiment, which was this guy. Which I don't think ever was a part of the song.
So you don't see it in here now? Because,
well, it's in the session, but I don't hear it in the blend.
Okay.
Let's listen and find out.
Well, the years start coming and they don't stop coming. Fed to the rules and I hit the ground running. Didn't make sense not to live for fun. Your brain gets smart, but your head gets...
I mean, mean, if it is, it's really subtle. I definitely hear this. I definitely hear that in there. And this is wildly out of time as well. So I'm not sure what the deal was with this.
Huh.
But I don't think it was used. Okay. And so then in the choruses, this thing gets added. It's just one of the coolest drum loops of all time. It was used on a Beck song.
Mm-hmm.
This was in Devil's Haircut, I think.
Right, yeah.
And,
got a lot of nice swing to it.
Yeah. And then we used it again on that on the same song. I was Force Field.
Oh, yeah.
On Force Field. On the third record, yeah. Okay, and so then here's the filtered drum loops for the bridge, the little breakdown bridge thing. So I think that's all you on the Dr. B.
I think so.
Yeah.
Huh.
Opens up at the end. And then there's this one too. Some bass snuck in the beginning of that.
Yeah. So is that from the demo, or is that, did we actually do that, redo that?
I don't know for sure. I do remember doing...
I don't know why there's bass in there.
Yeah, this one may be from the demo. Yeah, so that's how they add it up. And so check this out. Here's another thing that was not used in the final version of the song. Hand claps.
The car wash.
Yeah. Joe wanna get paid. Oh, yeah, terrible. Only shooting stars break them up. So, yeah, so I think that was a good choice. Definitely didn't need those. Okay, so here is the mighty Paul Delisle.
Wow.
And so we were doing combinations of amps at the time. I think there's an SVT. There would be a combo that was specifically to be really plucky, and then one that had some reverb on it. And so, let's see here. So, I think that is... That sounds like it might be the DI, actually. It's not an amp at all. That sounds like a DI. That's the plucky little guy. And that was usually a little Vox.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of times I use my little AC-15 for that. And then...
What bass is that? Remember he was using the teardrop on a bunch of stuff, but I don't know if that was it.
Yeah, I don't remember. I don't remember what the bass was. And this is another amp sound, but to me it sounds like it's mostly that with this.
Right. Yeah. So the DI and the AC-15?
I believe so.
Yeah.
And so then, yeah, I think this other one, this is probably the SVT. And then it's a totally different bass sound for the chorus.
Fingers,
yeah, instead of pick. So there's a fuzzy guy. That's the SVT for sure. And that's the DI. Yeah, so these are actually mislabeled in the session. They're both labeled as amps, but I'm sure that... that second one's the DI. Okay. So now the iconic skank guitar. Okay. What do you remember about this sound?
I mean, I remember there being like a ton of reverb on the demo, and mm-hmm. I remember that I always have like a Fender reverb tank that I use for that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
But I know we were using Silvertone, Supro.
Yeah, I had a Fender Twin we used occasionally.
Right. I mean, that reverb sounds like more of like a Fender sort of.
Yeah, that reverb. Might have been the Twin.
Mm-hmm.
The other combination that we liked was I did have a Fender reverb tank and that into the AC30. Oh. We did that occasionally. And there's two amps here. And that is for sure the Silvertone.
Yeah.
In the reverb only mode, mm-hmm. you know?
Yeah, it has a specific.
Yeah, I know
dark
that sound.
Reverb.
But on the final thing, I believe it's all this. Mm-hmm. I don't hear any of that in the blend.
Fed to the rules and I hit the ground running. Didn't make sense not to live for fun.
Original mix. Let's see.
He won't told me the world is gonna roll me. The sharpest tool in the shed. She was looking kind of dumb with her thing.
And okay, and so then these cool little mute guitars come in.
I didn't realize it was so high.
Like, it's in two octaves.
Huh. Okay, I see.
And I remember this was a realization that I had around this time. It was definitely on your guys' second record.
Mm-hmm.
That when you're trying to get these kind of retro guitar sounds, that it never works when you put the mic right up on the amp.
Mm.
And so I really got into this thing of taking really funky old ribbon mics like the RCA Veracoustic. Remember those Veracoustic
mm-hmm,
mics? And put them, you know, at least 3, 4, 5 feet away from the amp. And so it sounds like this small guy is, you know, probably only a few feet away. And that's obviously like
way across,
yeah,
room, yeah.
You know, probably 15 feet away from the amp. And it just, it puts it in space. It just lives in its own world once you can hear the room wrapped around it, you know. And what else do you remember about when we actually tracked the basics for the song? So like when Urbana was playing the drums, were we trying to capture the bass and the guitar and everything else at the same time, or did he just play the loops and then we just overdubbed?
I don't know if I was actually there when he played the drums, to tell you.
Okay.
I think we obviously remember things differently, but I remember someone else playing the drums first and then that being
right
replaced.
a decision being made.
Yeah.
Ah.
I kind of think that's how this one went down, because I remember going, whoa, this sounds amazing now, you know.
Okay, wow. Yeah.
Does that make any sense?
That rings a bell.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I think that a lot of the guitars and bass and stuff like that were sort of tracked, you know, overdubbed or something like that.
Right.
At different times.
Yes. So. Okay. Yeah, so there's an initial round where the band played it.
Yeah, definitely.
And then I made a command producer decision
right.
to have the drums replayed.
This needs to sparkle, sparkle to it.
Sometimes you have to do that, you know?
Yeah.
It sucks.
Urbano's kind of like Harvey Keitel, you know?
Yeah, he's the wolf.
He comes in, clean things up.
Yeah. And, yeah. So, yeah, so I mean, it was definitely kind of a crazy time. I was in the middle of recording another record. I was in the middle of recording a Death Ray record.
Right,
when this came up. And so I had to ask them to please, can you guys just take a break for a weekend while we try and record these songs?
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah, I remember this was kind of a quick one.
Yeah.
I think that's kind of, it's instrumental, so to speak, of that song. You know, it's like, it wasn't exactly completely scientifically well thought out. You know, it's just kind of like, here's this, here's that, here's this, here's that. And, you know, a lot of times, you know, when things are recorded so great, all you have to do is, like, move faders a couple times, and then it's done.
You know, it's
kind of like listening to those old Beatles recordings.
Yep.
They were recorded so well that the mix is already there.
Right.
You know?
Right.
And, I mean, this everything sounds so great, you know?
Yeah, and there really is barely anything on this session. There's a little bit of, you know, the built-in EQ, you know, a little bit of high passing here and there. These are relatively small moves.
We had a lot less, and you had a lot less to work with back then too, so everything was so much more simple, you know?
Yeah, and I know that, like, you needed, like, I didn't have as much control and just power to really, like, create sounds in the mix, and you had to really get them right on the way in.
Commit.
Yep, because you'd run out of resources while you're mixing. I have a limited number of channels, and the EQ on the console, I had this Neve 8128 console, was pretty broad brush. Like, you can't totally carve the way you can with plug-in EQs. And so you had to just kind of get it right on the way in. It was a little bit haphazard the way this came through. And I think one of the benefits is that it didn't give us time to overthink anything. And I think the song benefited from it. So there is acoustic guitar on all the choruses, just adding to the sort of percussive attack of that part, adding definition to it. And this was, I don't know if you remember this mic, but we used it on all the acoustic guitar throughout this whole era. Like, it was probably even on Fush You Ming as well. I think I had it at that time. It was this Dirk Bronner stereo tube mic. Called the VS1 or V1S or something like that.
Mm-hmm.
And it's definitely that mic, because I would record in MS, and so there'd be one capsule facing the guitar and one in figure eight that's listening out in either direction.
Huh.
And you'd do the MS encoding trick, which right here I'm doing with this plugin. So what ends up happening is, here is a plugin I put on here. It's 0% blend, so it's just dry. I put it on there to be absolutely sure that it matches up with this one. This one is also 0% mix, and so it's all just the original signal, except one side is phase flipped.
Right. Yeah.
And so that's how you decode an MS signal. And so this is the cardioid, you know, M part, the mono part, and this is the figure eight sides part of it. And so these two are getting blended together into this bus here. And what happens a lot is there'll be one side that ends up with a little more low end than the other, because of the way they add up. And so
if you didn't flip that phase, you wouldn't really get the entire...
You would not hear the left and right perspective of it.
Okay.
They would just, it would just be a mono sound if these were both phased the same. And if I reverse the phasing of this, then left and right, the image actually reverses.
Okay.
Yeah. And so then this is also the same sound that the really cool third verse that happens. And I've had some people ask me if this is even a real guitar, if it was a sampled guitar, because it sounds so whatever, you know,
yeah,
incredibly clear and kind of perfect, you know.
Mm-hmm.
This was at a time when, we were trying to get the most incredible, perfect sounds we could, using this, expensive, fancy stereo tube mic. And back then I was much more into, like, having nice new strings on the guitar and everything sounds, like, really bright and pristine, you know.
Probably haven't changed those since, huh?
Yeah. There's a certain point where it's like, the older the strings, the better, you know.
Yeah, don't wash your hands before you play guitar.
Yeah. Yeah. And so this really sounds like that era, you know. Okay, so then the chorus guitars. So in recent interviews, I did get this right where it's, quadruple tracked this part, and there's a brighter, sort of attackier, kind of wiry sound, and then there's a little thicker, kind of fuzzier sound. And so this is the brighter sound. Mm-hmm.
And do you remember what this guitar was?
I remember you were playing a Strat a lot on the second record, and always that Mose Wright was a popular choice.
Yeah.
The Mose Wright was more for like big heavy stuff.
Yeah, but that doesn't sound like those. The other thing that we really liked, and I think we actually brought it back for this record, was the Univox Les Paul copy that we borrowed from someone's cousin's brothers that found it under a bed in a closet.
Was it my guitar or your guitar?
No, it was like a friend of Steve's.
Oh, okay.
And we had it on the first record, and we brought it back. I was able to borrow it. I actually wanted to buy it, and at that point they wouldn't sell it because they knew how... Even though I lived under a bed for 30 years. But the Univox Les Paul copy was something that we were messing around with. Right. And then we started kind of collecting some Univox, old Univox guitars.
Yeah, and I got that Univox bass.
And I don't know if that that couldn't have been the Wilson, but...
it's definitely not the Wilson, because that was flat wound strings. It's definitely for sure my small Vox Cambridge.
Definitely.
Yeah, it's that amp.
So that's the same part, but close mic and away mic.
These two tracks.
Yeah.
Let's see. Let's listen to each one. I think they're basically the same sound, just doubled. No, that is a little different.
Yeah.
That sounds more like a bridge pickup.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting. Okay. So then there's this pair.
It sounds like a big cab, so
yeah,
it may have been, you know, like the super lead or, you know, one of your Marshalls or something like that, just not too distorted.
Yeah.
Is that what it was?
It could have been the Super Lead, but there's reverb on it too. I'm not really sure where that is.
Yeah, but sometimes we would send things through the tank.
Right. I think this is the Mose Wright.
Yeah, that sounds like the Mose Wright.
Yeah. That was, what a cool guitar that was, man. So much attitude in that guitar.
Yeah. I
love that thing. All right, so then later on, there's this cool transition in the third verse where it goes from just the acoustic guitar, and then we have all these cool arpeggiated guitars. Yeah, so that's definitely a magnetone amp, for sure. That crazy magnetone vibrato. And then, string.
Yeah.
Now, is this that DeArmond 12-string, or it could have been my Hagstrom?
I think it could have been the. I think it's probably the Hagstrom, because I don't know if we ever made use of that DeArmond too much.
Yeah.
But I also had a Mose Wright 12-string. I don't know if you remember that.
Yeah.
That I got from, I believe, the Dwarves.
Oh, cool.
Sold it to me or something, but that one, I don't know if we ever had any success with that, but I think that's your Hagstrom.
Yeah. Love that sound. Yeah. Okay, so now we get into keyboard land. We already talked about the little trill here, this guy. Yeah. Adorable.
So you have a dry one, and then the other one,
trails so it's
off.
Pure dry on that side, and then all delay with feedback on the left side. And so here's some outtakes. That. So these are just me trying to get the part. Yeah, playing the part over and over again, and then I thought it would be cool to have like a pulsing thing. Makes sense not to live for fun. Your brain gets smart, but your head gets dumb. So much to do, so much to... That was a bad idea.
Little B-52s action going on.
Right, yeah. We didn't use that. Yeah.
We should do a remix of just that hand clap.
All the misfit parts. I just had... Oh, yeah.
Oh.
Yeah. So this was a Hammond console organ that had that cool reiterate feature right. on it, right? Yeah. Dogs break the mold. It's a cool place, and they say it gets colder. You're bundled up now, wait till you get older. But the media so, men beg to dip. That lost. Life picture, the ice we skate is getting pretty thin. And clearly, the water's getting warm, so you might as well swim. This one, this little organ guy.
Mm-hmm. Church lady.
Yeah. Oh, in the satellite picture, the ice we skate is getting pretty thin. The water's getting warm, so you might as well swim. My world's on fire, how about yours? That's the way I like it, and I'll never get bored. Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game up. Oh yeah. We gotta go back real quick.
Okay. I think I know what you're about to.
Yep. Where is it? I just heard it. Oh, here it is. You're not in the drum area.
Is this the Chicky Chickies?
What are you doing down here? You should be up with the drums. So you were asking if there are any toms in this song. There are. And they go a little something like this. Isn't that incredible? I think that's from a Drum Drops record.
Mm-hmm. That's the way I like it and I'll never get
bored. So good. And I think there's a big long one. Hey now. Yeah, you hear the beginning of the fill here.
Nice.
So cool. Hey now, you're an all-star. Okay.
I have a question.
Yeah.
Did we not do separate ch-ch-ch on the guitars?
No.
We didn't.
Mm-mm.
Okay.
Yeah. You got a powerful chicka.
Okay.
Greg. All right. They stood out just fine.
Okay.
Okay, so now we get into the bridge stuff. And so you were expressing your DJ skills with this.
And, whack DJ.
Yeah. He's better than he'll ever admit, for sure. But
in the 90s, we were all trying to scratch.
Yeah. Yeah. That would definitely win over favors from the ladies.
So low,
that's so
you
good.
Can't hear it.
Okay, wait a minute. Break the mold. Okay, yeah, I don't know if that was actually in the final break mix. The mold. No, that was not in the final mix. Okay, so then. So this, I do remember, you performed this stuff into the computer,
mm-hmm.
and I comped it together and
right.
tried to like get everything to really, you know, line up with the drums and stuff. And go for the moon. Go for the moon. Maybe it would be. I remember being very excited about this particular phrase. Just the way it sits against the track is so cool because it has this like 16th note triplet implied. Right. It's really cool. So then the other part, and I remember experimenting with quite a few things for this. We ended up with the toy piano.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And this one, this is the version that is used in the final mix. This has this process on it. There's this plugin called the Vinylizer.
Oh.
And so I ran it through that because, you know, I recorded it with, I think, the 47 tube mic, and it was just so bright and so hi-fi that it mm-hmm. was like, this thing sounds like it's coming from another planet. And that's the original recording.
Sounds like you're
And so the only reason that this ended up on there is because I was in the middle of making a record with Death Ray, mm-hmm. and this was their toy piano they had left at the studio. And so
thank you, Death Ray.
Yeah. And so, yeah. Do you remember any of the other stuff that we tried?
No, not on this one.
Yeah.
Like I said, I think it was just so bare bones, you know?
Right. And so, vinylized toy piano and the whistling. That's you, isn't it?
Yeah, I think that's me.
Yeah. And I'm trying to remember if this just went straight to tape or if we had to record it into the computer at all or...
I don't know. It sounds kind of like pitch perfect, so I wonder if
it needed some help. Bit.
Go for the moon.
Where did this melody come from? This just fell out of your brain?
Yeah. That was on the demo too.
Yeah.
I just wanted to whistle. A song that had a whistle that would be hooky that people would whistle.
Right, cool. Because it's not on this instrumental demo, so you must have added it.
It is on the vocal demo, though.
Yeah.
Which I'm still trying to find.
Right. Yeah.
For the moon.
For the moon. Okay. Vocal land. Here we go. The mighty Steve, the King Harwell. The King. That was...
To this day, all he has to do is go, some, and everyone just sings the rest of the song.
That's amazing. You know, I haven't been to one of your guys' shows in a long time. I would love to do
that. It's kind of amazing.
Yeah, I want to experience that.
We've had a few Beatles moments where you're just like, I can't even hear anything anymore.
Wow.
It's just like crazy.
Wow, that's amazing. So...
Somebody once told me the world is gonna roll me.
So good.
I ain't the sharpest tool in the shed.
And it's, you know, what I've always really loved about Steve's voice, it is so distinct. I mean, there's just nobody else
nobody
in this universe that sounds like that man. And it was one of the things that really was attractive to me about the band when your guys' demos first came my way, mm-hmm. you know. And it's something I'm always looking for is a unique, very distinct individual, you know, mm-hmm. lead vocal sound, because it's at the end of the day, it's the only part that I can't do anything. Like I'm not mm-hmm. going to sing on somebody else's thing. Right. Like everything else, depending on the circumstances, like if you can't write it, if you can't play it, if you can't, whatever,
mm-hmm.
I'll figure it out.
Right.
But if the voice isn't great, there's nothing you can do about it.
Yeah.
And that is one of the most, you know, identifiable lead vocal voices of all time.
For sure.
And at this time, I was definitely using an SM7. His voice sounds incredible through an SM7. And using my favorite 1176 compressor. Mm-hmm. And this stuff... It may have been tracked to tape originally, but then I transferred into the computer because there was this... sometimes I'd transfer and just do the comp quicker. Comping on analog tape is a little cumbersome. Mm-hmm. There was ways to get really good at it, and so you can do it quickly. Have all the various takes on different faders, and you could sort of perform the comp, just switching between different faders and have it all bounce onto another track, so you'd have a comp. You can just punch it on, you know, little bit by little bit. There was a particular digital process that I really liked for his voice that would only happen in the computer. And it was this weird thing called vocal refresh.
Hmm.
Do you remember me?
I don't remember that at all.
Okay. And so definitely on Astro Lounge, all of his vocals were refreshed.
Hmm.
And so it was this crazy thing. There was this standalone application called SonicWorks, spelled with an X at mm-hmm. the end. And I think it was some German-made software, and they just had all these crazy algorithms for manipulating audio files. Mm-hmm. And one of them was called Vocal Refresh. And it did this insane thing where you have the waveform of the pitches and some overtones in there that are sort of the characteristic of his voice, depending on the vowel and stuff. You know, the overtones will change a little bit. And what the software would do is it would follow the main waveform and add a tiny little saw wave.
I do remember that.
On top of everything.
Yes.
And so it has this tiny little jagged saw wave. And so you always know when it's on there because you can see it immediately.
Whoa.
And so when I zoom in here, look at that.
Wow.
This tiny little dee 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 dee. And so at the end of the day, it adds this bright sort of airy overtone across everything and just sort of unifies the whole sound. And so
You still have access to that?
I don't.
Ugh.
Yeah, there was a certain point where, you know, they weren't really developing the application anymore, and I couldn't get a copy of it, you know. But it is cool. It was a really, really cool trick. So yeah, Vocal Refresh on there. And so, Steve's voice, it's a huge sound. He has a lot of overtones. There was already a lot of air and breath on his sound. And
somebody once told me
Vocal Refresh just sort of enhanced that further, just brought it out even more. And then I love the way his voice doubles. Fed to the rules and I hit the ground running. Didn't make sense not to live for fun. Your brain gets somehow smart, because there's always this overtone that's present in his voice all the time, even when the double didn't match up exactly, it still somehow would sound like they match because all the overtones still match. People that have very, very pure sounding voices, when they try and double, if they don't line up exactly, it really stands out.
Yeah.
Well, the years start coming and they don't stop coming.
So halfway through the verse, double comes in.
Back streets, you'll never know if you don't go. You'll never shine if you don't glow. Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game on, go.
That gets real bright right there.
Yeah, so I turn up this double. And and then the sort of group background vocals come in. So this is you and Paul.
Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game on, go play.
And we double tracked it. So that's a total of four voices there. Plus Steve being doubled. So it's a total of six voices, which probably by today's standard is not that many voices. But
yeah,
it was about as big as a gang as we could fit under the tape machine at the time.
Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game on. Go play. Hey now.
And I don't know if you remember this, but I did an initial mix of the song. And we sent it in. Everybody was excited about the song. And I only got one feedback. One little bit of feedback from Jimmy Iovine, and he said, I want to hear more of Steve's voice in the chorus, you know? You know, like, he's the sound of Smash Mouth. You got to be able to hear his voice. Mm-hmm. And I think he was right.
Yeah.
You know, when I did the original mix of the song, I really balanced everybody very uniform, so you could hear an equal amount of you, Paul, Steve, just a big gang of folks.
Mm-hmm.
And he was like, no, we got to hear Steve in front with the gang, you know? And so I had to go back and try to recall the mix, which I was not planning on doing because I was in the middle of another record. And it was like, we have no time. Here you go. Here's your finished mix, you know? And I didn't make any notes or anything. And so I had to try and recall the song. And I, you know, couldn't really get the whole song to come back. It was going to be way too difficult to do that. And so what I ended up doing is only recalling the chorus. And I edited that into the original mix.
Wow.
And so if you listen to the original mix, the drum sound, the whole thing changes a little bit when it goes into the chorus.
Huh. You'll never shine if you don't glow. Hey now, you're an all-star. Get your game on, go play. Hey now, you're a rock star, get the show on.
So let's hear that.
No, if you don't go, you'll never shine if you don't glow. Hey now, you're an
The drum sound clearly changes, you know.
That's probably okay.
Yeah.
Things got added there.
Mm-hmm.
The volume jumped up. And
yeah. And so yeah, ultimately, I think it was probably a cool thing to have it do that because, it made the chorus have more of its own distinct sound that just sort of happens mm-hmm. as an event, you know. Mm-hmm. I actually, you know, work very hard to force that to happen in mixes and will, like,
right, yeah.
you know, intentionally change things in the chorus, but that made it happen unavoidably. So then at the end of the chorus, there's this thing.
And all that glitters is gold.
Right. The bullhorn thing.
Yeah, and I had a few different ways to do that. I mean, now people just use plugins, but I had an actual mouthpiece from a phone mm-hmm. that we would use to record, and if you wanted to sound like a telephone. Mm-hmm. And I also had a bullhorn. I think this is the bullhorn. It's labeled as bullhorn, and it sounds kind of distorted like that. Do you remember what this was?
I remember we had like a bunch of toy mm-hmm. bullhorns and stuff like that that we did for another song.
Right.
Was that one of them, or was that an actual?
It was probably the toy one.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I also remember you had a microphone mounted in a Folgers can that had a.
Oh right.
Really weird.
Yeah, I would use that for guitars.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
But that doesn't sound like one of those.
Yeah. Yeah, I think it was probably the little toy bullhorn.
Mm-hmm.
And I think originally you sang this line on the mm-hmm. chorus.
Yeah.
And not just on the demo, but on this version as well.
Oh, really? So
yeah. Okay. And then we swapped it out to Steve at some point in the process. Yeah. And so, because this is definitely Steve.
Yeah. Is gold.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's a cool place, and they say it gets colder. You're bundled up now.
So that organ only happens once.
The media men beg to differ. Judging by the hope in the satellite picture. The ice we skate is getting pretty thin. The water's getting warm, so you might as well swim. My world's
yes, the only place we ended up using.
That's the way I like it, and I'll never get bored. Hey now, you're
yeah, it's being played through the whole song. yeah, it's definitely not needed. And then what happens here? It's interesting. Me still trying to shoehorn that reiterate effect in there.
But we ended up using it on many other things, though.
Yeah,
I
yeah. I was determined. Yeah.
Muskrat.
Right. Yeah, all right. Well, that's kind of all the tracks. Is there anything else you remember about?
I mean, I don't remember so much about, you know, like all this stuff. Like, I mean, it's fun to look at and listen to. I just remember being stressed out about the actual trying to deliver the song and make it
right.
So the rest of the record was going to get heard because we were so proud of it at that point. We're like, this is amazing, you know.
Yeah.
So I mean, I'm just happy that this worked out quickly and. That you were able to take a weekend off from Death Ray to work it out, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Everything was moving so fast, there was really no time to think about anything. I never had any thought about, you know, if people would really love this song or if it would be great at a sports arena or, like, none of that, you know?
None of it, yeah. You know, I remember, you know, when, you know, two songs were written at the same time, right, in the same couple days, which was mm-hmm. All Star and Then the Morning Comes. And I personally liked Then the Morning Comes, and I thought thought that was going to be the single. I thought this was too, for us, a little too poppy mm-hmm. and just too obvious or so, I don't know.
Yeah.
Like, not obvious for the band, but just for radio and everything. And so,
yeah.
I mean, those are the things that I remember about this time more than the actual recording part of it, because you were there much more than
right.
You worked on this, you know, much longer than we did.
And I remember when you brought the song in and we listened to it, we all listened to it together, that we had a discussion about the effect that this song would have on your band.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember saying something like, this song will definitely do what the record company wants it to do. And is asking for, but this song could sail your band straight into the sun.
Mm-hmm.
You know, yeah. there's no turning back.
I remember this.
And ultimately, you know, I think it was your guys' choice, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And everybody decided it was the right thing to do, you know.
Yeah. It just seemed like the next step for us, you know.
Yeah.
You know, coming off of, you know, Walking on the Sun, you know, people wanted to hear more of that sort of vibe. Right.
Yeah.
And not so much of, you know, the thing that we originally did was a little more like punk rock and rock, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
And so
is there any regrets about having this song become such
not
a
at
huge,
all. Not
you know,
at all.
Taking over everything, you know?
Not at all. You yeah. know, it was the vehicle to get the rest of Astro Lounge heard, which it did, you know.
Right.
And people still, you know, talk to me about that and how great it sounds and, you know, sonically and, you know, just the way that record came together. It was just, it's so fun to listen to, and not very many people would have heard it had it not been for All Star.
You know? Yeah. Yeah. I think that's, you know, at the end of the day, that's always sort of the biggest gift of, you know, something like this, is that it just brings, you know, a whole musical expression, which is a whole record, to so many more people.
Right.
And
we were just, we got through that window as it was closing, you know, because now it's just really a song. It's a song, or even just a part of a song.
Right.
You know, that people listen to.
Yeah.
Not an entire record. They're like, whoa, I wonder what the rest of that album would sound like, you
yeah.
know?
Yeah.
And so I feel fortunate that we were around at a time that people still listened, you know?
Yeah, yeah. And, you know, I know we've both done a bunch of interviews about this song recently, and that's pretty much how I've ended every interview when they ask me, like, do you have any other thoughts about this? And the thing that I always say is, I just could not be more grateful to have had the opportunity to be a part of this song, you know?
Yeah.
And,
well, I mean, we've always thought of you as the fifth member of the group, you know? It's like, it doesn't work really without you. You know, it's like anything that we ever brought was realized by you, you know.
Mm.
So, you know, the feeling is obviously mutual.
Yeah, yeah. Well, that's very generous. And you know, I think in particular, your and I creative collaboration has been, I think, probably the most fruitful, most effortless, and most enjoyable out of, you know, all
right.
the stuff that I've worked on. So
again, mutual.
Yeah. Awesome. Well, thank you for checking it out. I hope you enjoyed it. I hope there was something helpful in there. It was really fun to go through all that again and just relive that experience. But that is it. That is All Star. And we'll see you another time. All right.
Bye.
Bye. You put the who's in. On the whatsy, attach the whatsy to the whoosie, connect the thingamajig to the thingamabob, and that'll make the whatchamacallit go. You hook the gidget to the gadget, adjust the gadget to the gidget, unhook the dingley dang from the diddly doo, that seems to sort of settle the so and so. When the you know doesn't almost, and the gizmo never quite.